Anything else?
All set?
Governor, would you clarify a little bit what the, your position is on funding for MLS stadiums in Minneapolis? Will the state participate?
Well, I'm going to say definitively that it won't be any participation because I don't know what the ask is. You know, what I said was I don't believe there's any public or legislative support, or I shouldn't say any. I don't think there's majority legislative support, I'll leave it at that, for kind of, you know, subsidies or incentives that directly related to a stadium for Major League Soccer, such as have been, you know, forthcoming for some of the other teams and facilities that have been built in the last decade or two. But I'm not going to say that, as I tried to make the point yesterday, that if there's an exchange that MnDOT's involved in that's on the list to do anyway, and or it needs to be expanded, it's like the one now with TCAP, now that site is being cleared, that there needs to be another exit ramp or at least an extension or expansion of the ramp that's already planned. I mean, I don't want to put myself into a corner and say, you know, none of that would be considered or whatever, but there's not going to be, as far as I know, any legislative support for anything that goes beyond, you know, basic infrastructure that would be occurring otherwise, given the development that would be coming.
You may be aware that after the MLS franchise was announced, the commissioner of the league said that there is a deadline on knowing whether there's a stadium, suggesting that perhaps it would have to move elsewhere.
I mean, that's the prerogative of the league. I'm not privy. I didn't meet with the commissioner. I don't know what, you know, has been discussed with the principals, but I think that a number of the legislative leaders and other local public officials and myself have been trying to state directly to the league and to the ownership of the team, we're delighted that you're coming to Minnesota, we're excited about it, but you shouldn't look to the public sector for any participation in this. And if the owners of this prospective new team would take that card off the table, I mean, I would have been there yesterday and I would have been enthusiastic in my support because, you know, I think it's great that Major League Soccer is coming here, but I think it should be very clear to everybody who's gotten involved, and I believe this has been communicated to the league itself, and I believe it's been communicated to the owners, I don't know directly, but I believe it has been, that there isn't going to be support from state government, state capital, in the way there was for the other stadiums, TCF and the Target Field.
Did I understand you to say that you did not attend because of that?
I didn't feel comfortable being seen as and I tried to make that distinction throughout. I had other commitments, so I'm not going to say that I wasn't there for that reason. But I've tried to be very clear in the indirect communications I've had with some of the principals. Just what I'm trying to say here today, that, you know, there's not, in my view, there's not going to be public support for subsidizing a new stadium.
But it made me feel uncomfortable.
Governor, why? The state has subsidized many sports arenas. Why is soccer being left out?
What was it? I read today. What was the term? Preference, indicating preference for one over the other. I mean, I just think politically there's not going to be public. I think the term of stadium fatigue describes it. If the legislature, myself, and the general public, there's certainly people very enthusiastic aficionados of soccer, and that's great. And the point's been made that among the younger generation is probably even stronger, and it's a coming sport and the like. But, you know, for bringing a new team here, I just don't think there's, you know, public appetite for taking on financing of another stadium. So I've made it, you know, trying to make it very clear in the beginning, great that you're coming and great to the ownership, great that you're willing to bring this franchise and this excitement and opportunity to Minnesota, but you're gonna have to go it alone. And I don't know whether others are going to find some way to get involved or not, but you know, that's my position.
Governor, the issue of public funding aside, let's say that the July deadline, for lack of a better word, that the Commissioner Garber has set, nothing's happening or things aren't coming together, would you consider, as the chief executive of the state of Minnesota, of getting involved and trying to facilitate something for the long-term good of Minnesota in that regard?
I don't foresee doing anything that contradicts anything I've said today and said previously on this subject. If that's the deadline, then we'll have to see what the situation is at that time. But I don't have any intention to go beyond what I've said today.
So you wouldn't get involved if this wasn't gelling and the July 1st was coming?
I have no expectation that I will.
How about another sports topic as far as Super Bowl, the kind of additional tax break, for lack of a better term, for NFL?
Well, I haven't had kind of communication with anybody in the league or at the host committee about the additional state subsidies for the Super Bowl game. I mean, I think we've been awarded the event, and we're excited it's coming, and the tax exemption that's on the books from the 1992 Super Bowl remains. It was made clear at the time the bid was submitted that is a continuing commitment. It's worth about $9.2 million, as I recall. But there was nothing else that anybody had agreed. We have a letter signed by the four caucus leaders and myself that makes that explicitly clear, and I don't have any, no one's asked me to change from that position. Now, I've read or seen that a couple of the leaders have been approached by representatives of somebody to make additional concessions. I'm not aware of those directly, so I can't comment on them. Nobody's asked me. And if members of the legislature want to carry legislation that's going to add something to what's already there, they certainly have a prerogative of doing so. I just think it's got to be public and up front, and might get every 201 legislators a chance to weigh in on it.
Governor, speaking of taxes, House Republicans the other day set their target at $2 billion in unspecified tax cuts. What do you think of that, and how big a divide will that be to bridge
Well, I met with the Republican leadership this morning at our biweekly breakfast, and I met with the DFLers a couple of days ago, and I said, I'm really going to look at the statute. Now, I'm required to put out a budget that's precisely and corroborated by MMB and using numbers that are verifiable, exactly my tax proposal and exactly my spending proposal, and they come up with these quote-unquote targets that, I don't know what's in them in terms of the details. So I don't know. I did make the point that I think taking $2 billion in revenues this year and shifting another $600 million in revenues to transportation dedicated projects, that's $2.6 billion is coming in permanently out of the revenues for the state of Minnesota. I don't know if it's feasible to do it because I haven't seen their whole budget proposal, if it's feasible to fit that all in for this coming biennium, but it's certainly gonna come back and haunt those who are gonna be around here in the subsequent bienniums. And we learned that lesson. We had that experience in the early 2000s. And the saying goes, if those who don't learn the lesson of history are doomed to repeat its mistakes. I mean, it's just setting us up for another fiscal collapse and borrowing from the schools and all the things that we spent the last 4 years digging Minnesota out of, and the growing Minnesota economy has spent getting us out of. And now people who just evidently don't remember or don't care about what happened back then seem to be prepared to do it again. But I don't know what the details are, whether these are permanent tax cuts or these are one time, and if so, how they're going to be structured and the like. But $2.6 billion out of the revenues, even for this next biennium, is a big, big bite.
But could you be open to more tax cuts?
Compromise means you agree to things you don't agree with. And we're obviously, I'm going to have to compromise if we're going to get a resolution and avoid the serious problems that occurred in 2011, we're going to have to get, everyone's going to have to compromise and accept something that they don't agree with, and I'm willing to do my part in that. I was willing to do my part in that in 2011.
Speaking of 2011, do you agree with Leader Thiessen that what the Republicans laid out is a recipe for a shutdown?
I hope not. I can't speak for, you know, the House, you know, the majority or the minority caucuses. I mean, all this is, you know, speculative at this point. Again, as I said, there are going to be need to be compromises made if it's, anything's going to be resolved. I'm hopeful that enough of the legislators were around, as I was in 2011, to remember how awful that was, and you know, avowed not to repeat it. But there's all, you know, that remains to be seen. It depends on everybody willing to, you know, to make the necessary compromises and come to necessary agreements. So you know, I don't want to. I'm not going to venture force into predicting that myself.
Governor, how about how you're going to match up with the Senate? We'll get their targets tomorrow, and Senator Bach says it's going to be a mix of tax cuts, spending, and putting money in reserves, and he disagrees with your approach on spending at all. Is there another Bach-Dayton showdown brewing?
No, I mean, that's the role of, you know, the legislative branch. They're elected in their own right, and again, I put my budget out there about 6-7 weeks ago, and I said to the Republican leadership today, you know, I put it out there in like a pinata, and everybody gets a whack at it for 6 weeks because that's the only thing hanging. And now we got, you know, the Republican proposal, you know, doesn't specify the cuts in education and what happens to early childhood scholarships or all day pre-K or a lot of other things. So it's pretty hard to be critical of something that is so nebulous. And I'd say the same about what I expect the Senate targets to be too. It doesn't specify the trade-offs that are going to be involved. If you do this, you can't do something else. And that's just the reality, even within a $40 billion budget. It's finite. And ultimately, at the end, it's got to balance and it's got to be verifiable. And that's a whole different scenario than when you're putting out the targets that don't define what it is you're going to do.
But should the state's top two Democrats be on the same page?
No, not necessarily. The top, I don't know how many DFLers are in the legislature, but they don't all agree with one another. They don't all agree with me. That's the wisdom of democracy. No one's supposed to get their way all the time. And you know, the collective wisdom is what ultimately has served this country better than, as Winston Churchill said, it's the worst form of government except for all the rest. And it's proven that statement true time after time here and across the globe. It's the wisdom of people with very different views and opinions and the like, and everybody, you know, comes in with theirs, and there's, you know, the turmoil and gnashing of the teeth, and keeps all of you employed, keeps all of us employed, you know, if we're just, you know, but it serves the process. So I told my commissioners they don't agree with me. I appreciate it to let me know in advance, but I mean, and they have, and that's, you know, because they got to be true to their own convictions and to what the constituency out there that they represent. So I think it's kind of, you know, as long as people are being honest with the numbers and are being forthright, and are willing to acknowledge the consequences of one decision or another, including myself, that's healthy. You know, and then people can say, how's this going to affect me? How's this going to affect my community? How's it going to affect the state now, 5-10 years from now? And we can have that, you know, sifting of ideas and different views, and, you know, that's what the process is supposed to work. The only problem I have is when people are not forthcoming or candid about the real consequences of what they're proposing and trying to be something to everybody, which is not possible.
Is the House not being honest about their?
I'm not going to say that. You know, again, they set targets. I don't know what's in those targets. I mean, if you're taking $2 billion for tax cuts and $600 million out of the general fund for transportation, and we've got a $2 billion surplus, I mean, anybody can do that math. But I don't know where that money comes from. So I don't know how to. I can't critique something that's not defined. Same thing with the Senate, I'll say in advance. I mean, you can't critique something that's presented in their way, according to their numbers, in ways that, you know, understandably, you know, serve their purpose and cast it in the best light. And that's why when they come back in 10, you know, 2 weeks, we'll have a chance to look at over time at the specifics. You know, what taxes are going to be cut, for how long, which are permanent, which are one time, if there are. You know, what does it mean to take $600 million and put it into transportation instead of the general fund? Where does that come out of? I can look at my budget, I can say, you've got to take $600 million out, you're not going to have early childhood education, you're not going to have universal pre-K unless you savage some other part of the budget. I could say that, but I'm not going to say it in an accusatory way until I know the facts, and the facts will be forthcoming over the final 2 months of the session. And then, you know, and then these numbers are going to get real.
Governor, why did you support a $10 an hour minimum wage at the airport rather than 15, which advocates have been asking for?
I thought it was a big step forward. You know, and I think it's achievable. I think it's something that the Airports Commission can do, should do. I mean, that airport's not going to South Dakota or Cambodia. So it's here, it's a publicly owned facility. It ought to reflect the values of the public. It ought to set the marker for the private sector and for others in the public sector. And if we got to $10 an hour across the board at this stage right now, with the minimum wage, state minimum wage being $8 and $7.15 just less than a year ago, I think that's significant progress.
Governor, when we talked to the MAC about this, it tells us that they don't have the power over private contracts.
Oh, yeah, dude, sure they do. They have the power over anything goes on if they want to take it or insist on it. And I don't know what the private contracts say, because they're existing contracts that can't come in unilaterally change them. But they can state that there's a $10 minimum wage required in all contracts, subsequent contracts, whatever. And the commission has just not been willing to take these on. The commission can't hide behind these private contracts, or it's not Delta, or it's not this, it's not that. They've had 20 years before I took office of doing that, and being complicit with these private sector decisions that are made. That here's a guy I put on the commission board making $12.50 an hour 4 or 5 years ago. Now he was making $7.50. Now he's up to $8. He has 5 children and a spouse to support, and he works cleaning out cabins and cleaning out all this and doing ferrying people around for $7.50 an hour. And to the commissioner, or you know, for anybody in the public sector, to turn around and say, "Well, we can't do anything about that," I don't agree.
Governor, is this something that had been brewing behind the scenes, and you've been in contact with MAC board members before and just said something yesterday, or is this the first they're learning of it too?
That's the first they were learning about.
And have you received any initial feedback?
Some of it, my staff have talked with some of them, and I don't know. I never know if you get how honest the feedback is. You know, they don't have to agree with me. I mean, the same thing as before. They don't have to agree. But and I fault myself for not raising this to the public light a couple of years ago. I mean, there really was a very direct experience meeting Commissioner Muhammad and his wife and learning the details of what he has gone through. And, you know, a couple of years ago, I remember bringing this up, and the airlines were not on the verge of bankruptcy, but they were in a very, you know, serious financial constraints. So it didn't seem like, you know, the time to pushing it. But in hindsight, I wish I'd pushed it, you know, 4 years ago. And press the members of the commission whom I've appointed to have taken the lead on this sometime. So that's my fault. That's not their fault. And now we got to make up for all this time.
Is this an issue that you talked with your appointees about before you appointed?
I talked with a couple of them before. Yes.
And are they supportive of your position to at least $10 an hour?
I have to ask them. I don't know.
Could you expand a little bit on MAC is complicit with the private companies?
Well, I'm really talking more historical, but I'm including my first 4 years.
But they are now, too, with Delta, with all of these companies.
I've been frustrated for probably the 15 or 20 years preceding my taking office with the MAC's position on, the commission's position on issues that affect the public interest, where I felt there was undue deference given to the major airlines, starting with Northwest and now it's Delta, on matters. And those are my personal opinions as a citizen. And, you know, if I look back now and say, well, I wish I'd, you know, acted sooner in my now second term than I did, and then I have, I would confess that I didn't follow up on this as early as I wish I had. So I take responsibility for that. So now I'm stepping up and doing it, and it is what it is.
Anything else?
Governor, doesn't raising the minimum wage for a select group of employees raise the same fairness questions that reducing the minimum wage for a select group of employees?
I mean, that should be debated on its merits or demerits. And I'm for raising minimum wages. I've not ever been for reducing them. And in this case, where these people are, it's their sole source of income. You don't tip the person who cleans the lavatories or anything like that. This is the income that they get for the work they do. And a lot of them are, you know, as I said, 40 hours a week, or sometimes working more. But I mean, this is what they their families live off of. And so to me, this is a really different situation. It's much more clear cut. And it's also, you know, something to say, well, I'm a small enterprise out in greater Minnesota, and I can't afford an initial dollar or $1.50 an hour to some of my employees, you know, and then my customers have to take that on the like. I mean, this is a big public entity serving, you know, millions of people with a major, you know, employer who, you know, we want to be successful, but certainly it's giving out the dividends, or not dividends, giving out whatever they're giving out. They're sharing their profits with employees, and I assume with their stockholders, which is fine. And but these creations that were approved before I became governor, of taking in somebody who was working before for the airline at $12.50 an hour, is now working for some subcontractor who's working for some contractor who's gets a contract with the Metropolitan Airport Authority, so they don't have to. So they can, they're going one or two steps removed from, you know, from our culpability is, to me, unacceptable. I mean, they can do it, but they should be held to a standard, which is it can be and should be enforced.
And have you studied this to the level where you know they could do this by decree, that they wouldn't need
it? I mean, again, I don't know all the details. If they have existing contracts, they probably can't. But they can, if they determine to do that, they can work their way through that, and over whatever period of time those contracts come up for renewal. If they set this as our policy, and first of all, you've got the, you know, public spotlight on the fact that those that are not in compliance, and you've got an ethic, you're establishing that this is going to be the requirement from this point forward, and then, you know, the lawyers can handle the details from there.
Governor, you were anticipating your bonding proposal here, I assume, fairly soon. The House Republicans are saying $800 million is not in the mix as far as they're concerned. This legislative session would be next legislative session for them. And Senator Bach said no appetite over in the Senate. How do you change some minds on that?
All I can do is propose. You know, they dispose. They don't want a bonding bill this year. You can look at all the projects that I'm going to be presenting. I think it's April 6th now. Is that the date? And look at all the communities that would benefit from it, and all the citizens who would benefit from those projects. And, you know, a lot of them are their constituents. They can go back and tell them that we're not going to do this, even though we have the resources to do it, even though it's within my budget, the additional debt service. And I mean, these are jobs projects. I mean, they have long-lasting impacts on the communities and benefits. But these put people to work and doing the projects, and they, you know, restore, revitalize the campuses all over the state. For post-secondary institutions, then the students benefit, the faculty benefits, the communities benefit. So they want to go back and say, even with the resources available, you know, well, again, it's hard to say until they look at what else they have on their docket that they do want to do. But I'm glad to compare and contrast what $850 million would do in bonding for these projects all over Minnesota with some of the things that I expect will be forthcoming over time. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.